everyone. I'm going to talk to you about Vogue Knitting Live 2018. What an experience. If you're a knitter and you live in the New York City area, you are just so lucky to be able to go to Vogue Knitting Live. So I want to just first begin by introducing myself. My name is Shannon Bellum. I am a knitwear designer. I'm a university professor at a local university, local to me. I am in northern New Jersey in the United States. And I've been designing a really, really long time. I just haven't been designing for the hand knit market. I got my start designing knits for Joan Vass, who's was a huge, huge, huge hand knit designer, a huge just person in the New York City scene. She worked at the Metropolitan Museum as a curator for many, many years. She was super, super interesting, and I totally did not appreciate it as a young 20-year-old from California who just appeared at her doorstep and asked for a job, and she hired me. And I went on from there to do other things in the knitwear business. Knitwear was just really taking off. It was the 1980s, and I was a unicorn in a woven world, basically. So I was lucky. I was right place, right time kind of thing, and ended up catapulting to the top of the knitwear market. Cut and sew, mostly some machine knits and stuff like that. And I quit. Like you do. When you reach the top, you quit. I quit. I had children and I became a mom, and working in the garment industry, they want blood, sweat, and tears every day, and I couldn't do it anymore. So I became an academic, which is a much easier lifestyle for parents, and went to school. Got an MFA in studio art, did some art, dabbled in the art world, made some sculpture, made some jewelry, and continued to be interested in fashion. And the fashion folks on the campus that I work, when they found out that I had background and also the master's in studio arts, they grabbed me and roped me into teaching fashion classes. I think I've taught practically every single fashion class. There were just two of us for a while, and then they expanded their faculty, and I got to just teach the course that I'm very interested in. So that's just a brief background about me. I'm hoping this is going to be a regular thing, this podcast, and that you'll learn more about me and about why I'm doing what I'm doing along the way. So I don't really want to do a whole here's what I do kind of thing right now. I really want to try to focus on this Vogue Knitting Live, because I think this is why you're here. I'm going to talk a little bit about my works in progress and a little bit about my journey to Vogue Knitting Live. I also want to introduce Martha. This is Martha. She's my form, my dress form. She's me. In solid form. She's my proportions, so I use her to design from. She's amazing. I love her. She's wearing one of my knits, one of my designs, and probably the best thing about it is these amazing sleeves. This ruffle sleeve and the little ruffle bottom. I don't know. I don't think you can see. Wait, let me move her back a little bit. How about that? Can you see her bottom there? Her little ruffle bottom right here. So I con crunched this sweater to wear to Vogue Knitting Live. I really, really wanted to wear it. This sweater design is called Mist and Fury. You could find it on my Ravelry shop. You can find me on Ravelry as Bellum Make. Bellummake. I'll put the link down below, and also I'll put my show notes on Ravelry. because my assumption is that if you're a yarny knitter person, you're on Ravelry. And if you're not on Ravelry, you need to get on Ravelry. Don't be like me, where you were so late to the game. I didn't join Ravelry until last year, right around this time. I think it was no, maybe November 16 that I joined. And you'll get those stories if you watch, if you come back and watch my videos as we go. I'll tell you all those stories about my journey to Ravelry and stuff. It'll come out. But I don't want to focus on that now. So anyway, this is Martha's modeling my Mist and Fury sweater. This is my second prototype that I made. My first one is green. You can see everything on my project page, like all my, I am a meticulous note taker, so everything is on Ravelry. Everything, the yarns that I used, my patterns are all there for sale if you're interested in buying them. So yeah, this is Mist and Fury. And I was obsessed with getting Wollenvine yarns that were inspired by the same book by A Court of Thorn and Roses. And this is Feyre. So this yarn is Wollenvine's Feyre in her MCN base, which is, I think she pronounces it Volk base. And I found that Sweet Georgia yarn had a black called Cauldron, so that if you know the story, Cauldron is just perfect. And I wanted a black base for the bottom, and the only Cauldron I could get had little sparkles in it at the time when I really really wanted it. So, but this is Sweet Georgia yarn, does a really subtle shimmer, so it's really really pretty. I think it's complimentary. I don't mind, like, I'm not a big sparkle girl, so this was subtle enough that I think I can wear it year round. It doesn't seem like a Christmassy or festive time kind of sparkle to me. But oh my God, these sleeves, these sleeves. These are worth it. This is worth this sweater alone. Yeah. So that's Martha. And that's what Martha's wearing right now. I also want to just say that I hope my thoughts for the channel, and it's going to be kind of organic and grow as I learn. I am an educator, and I think an effective educator synthesizes information in a very unique and useful way for people to learn. And not everyone, there are people that are out there that are freaking geniuses, but they are not good educators. They're not effective educators. And I think I'm an effective educator, and I think it's a gift. I think I come from a very long, long line of teachers, and I don't know if it's genetic or environmental, or I certain my parents were not educators. My mother became an educator after I was an adult, but I don't know. I think it's something that I have a knack for, and my hope is that you learn from me. And I want to really, in my future podcast, I really want to talk about the design process. I want to crack open the window so you can see behind the curtain what happens in the design process, how artists and designers and makers make decisions, and how they come to the decisions that they make, and why they made, when what's the rationale behind that. And I think that is what I have to offer that's different from the usual knitters podcasts. So that's my hope and dreams for this podcast. I hope you come back for my second one. But without further ado, I'm gonna get into my journey to Vogue Knitting Live this year. This was my second time at Vogue Knitting Live. I first went last year, and I wore my first design for the hand knit market, and I got a lot of attention, and it was super exciting. But my design was not published, and I realized that that was a huge mistake, that people were chasing after all the shiny new objects that were at Vogue Knitting Live, and When they saw me, all I could say was, it will be published in a few weeks and it's not ready yet, but it will be published. And I learned, that was a good learning experience for me, not to wear a design that hadn't been published yet. So, yeah, so this time around I wore two designs that have already been published, and I got a lot of attention. Not so much for what Martha has on here, Mist and Fury, but for my other sweater, which I'll show you in a little while. It's called Big Bear Ski Bum. Very 70s inspired from my youth, my teenage years in growing up in California. Mist and Fury probably would have gotten more attention, but I wore her on Saturday, and Saturday it's madness. I took a little video. I may try to insert it. I'm learning this whole thing about video editing right now, so I'll become an expert soon. But for now, I'm just kind of like fumbling my way through it, I guess, like you do. Okay, I think I've talked enough about me. Let me talk to you about what I bought, and it's like all over at my feet here. So first off, I watched Christy Glass's video on what to go see. I had printed out the map. I want to show you the sixth floor, because the sixth floor is cuckoo crazy. So here you go. I printed this map, and I wrote notes. I was making my own notes, and then Christy came out with her amazing video explaining what to see from her perspective, and that was super informative. There were some things that I already had on my radar, and I just went through and pointed to, indicated where I should go. And then I knew I had to make some stops right away, because if you've ever been there, you know that things sell out. So here's my notes on what I had to do on Friday. So there were certain things that I felt like were important to get taken care of on Friday, because I knew things were going to sell out. So without further ado, I'm going to show you. My first stop was Long Island Yarn and Farm. And that was because Christy had said she had a limited collaboration with them, with Tabitha from Long Island Yarn and Farm. And I really wanted it. I don't know what I'm gonna do with this, but isn't it so pretty? It's a I think it's worsted weight. Let me just see. Yes, it's worsted. That's the tag. They completely sold out by, I think, before noon on Saturday. So I was lucky. And what I loved about this, too, was that the skeins were numbered. I got number 72 of 80. You can see right there. And it's indie dyed, right? So there were different shades and stuff, so I kind of was picky about what color I got. I could see some were brighter and some were a little darker and some were a little more faded, so I don't even remember what I ended up picking. I just went for the one that my eye was most drawn to. I first was like, oh, I want the lowest number, because as an artist you want the lowest number because that's the most valuable, in art speak. But then I was like, you know what? No. I need to pick the one that speaks to me. So yeah, super happy with this. And then I got in the same booth. Christy had talked about a pink shimmer that she had. So that she had knitted in a sweater. So this is also worsted weight. I don't really think you can see the shimmer too well on screen, but I just thought they looked interesting together, and I thought, I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm going to let these marinate. These are going to marinate a while. I'm going to come up with some idea of what to do with them. I might need more of the shimmer, but I can get it, so I'm not worried about that. I tried to be really purposeful in this Vogue Knitting live experience. I really wanted to pick things that I knew I couldn't get anywhere else, and I wanted to see things that I only see online sometimes, and I was purposeful. I spent all of last year, all of 2017, building a library of yarn so that I have, when I have an idea, I can go to my stash and pull things together. And if I need to fill in, I can fill in, but at least I have a good base. So that was my philosophy last year. So last year I bought. I have a really nice broad spectrum of indie dyed yarn. I love indie dyed yarn. I have hardly any commercial based stuff. Just not that wowed by it. I think I like all the, I love as I knit in the knitting process, I love to see the fabric develop. And I think you get a lot of excitement with indie dyed yarn. Okay, so I got those. And then my next stop was right across the aisle. I went over to, wait, let me see. I went over here. I went over to Do You Knit. I went over there. I did not get pimped. Because I don't need her for that. Maybe some people do. I don't need her to help me put colors together. I can do it myself. I kind of feel like I might get some hate for this, but I kind of feel like this store is like a must stop. It's like a touristy trap, kind of like the South Street Seaport in New York City. You go to New York City, you go to the South Street Seaport, you have oysters there, you pay double the money for oysters there that you would pay at some really nice place that's not in a touristy district, and you later are like, why did I pay twice what I needed to for oysters when I could have had perfectly fine oysters back home or whatever. But like, I think Do You Knit's kind of like that too, because she overcharges, and I don't know why. I don't know why. So I did go there, and I only went for this. This is the Hedgehog Fiber Vogue Knitting Live color. Yeah, it was expensive. It was more than what Hedgehog Fibers are anywhere else, and I don't understand price gouging. Being in the industry, being in the garment industry, I've been to so many trade shows, and I'm used to show specials, not show price gouging. So it's a little off-putting. I find it a little off-putting, and I don't know how to say that nicely other than to just like share what I'm thinking. And look, if you need help getting pimped with yarn, then she's amazing. Like she can do that for you, and you're paying for it though. Nothing's for free, right? Nothing is for free. Anyway, what do you think? I got these beautiful Hedgehog Fiber Vogue Knitting Live colors. This was all I bought Hedgehog wise. I have a huge selection of Hedgehog that I collected over the last year, that I got directly from Beata, from her online shop. I also did her Skinny Singles Club. I did a couple other clubs over last year till I really felt like my library of yarn was saturated. So I stopped collecting it, and just looking for one-off interesting. I also don't know what I'm going to do with this. I have no plan. I just thought it was really pretty, and it's right up my alley color-wise. You're going to see that I love these, like, gray, purpley, these, like, sort of gothy, like this, like, very gothy-looking colors. That's kind of my thing. But I do branch out into other colors. I get bored really easy. I don't know about anyone else, but I get bored very easy by color. And I'm used to this, like, pop, just from, I think it's part of my industry training of just, like, having this, like, quick, like, ah, done with that color. Ah, you know, I've got enough of that. I need something new. What's new? What's fresh? What's interesting? So I got really, really used to that, working in the industry. And then even slowing down in academia, I didn't lose that, that desire for new, interesting things. Okay, my next stop, if you saw my list before, I had to make a beeline to Stephen and Penelope. It was their first time showing at Vogue Knitting Live. I saw Stephen last year, and he was in the Do You Knit booth. I didn't talk to him, though. I find that a little weird, like, talking to people that you only know from online. I was just like, well, I don't think I really can do this. They don't know me. I know them, but they don't know me. So I just kind of looked at him and was like, oh, there's Steven. That's cool. Just like I did with many other, knitting people that have a strong online presence. And I actually met him later at the Do You Knit store. He was doing a book signing, so I went for the book signing. And yeah, he's cool. So sweet, so nice, and so approachable. Immediately asks you if you want a picture, and he and I chatted a little bit, and he commented on my colors and said how much he loved what I was picking out when I was at Do You Knit. So yeah, next, I made a beeline for his store, because I knew two of my three yarn dyers that I freaking love and follow obsessively on Instagram were there. And the two in particular, so Walk Collection was there. I didn't buy any Walk Collection. I have a lot of her yarn, Catherine Walk's yarn. I love it. I hope I'm saying her name right. It's spelled like walk, like our English word walk, but it might be walk, I'm not sure. I have a lot of her yarn, and I find her yarn accessible. I'm able to get it online. So again, I was trying to focus on things that are hard to get, hard for me to get, and hard for me to build on. So La Bien Aimée is not so easy to get in the United States. We have a hard time. You can, of course, buy it online directly from her when she does her shop updates, which she does a couple times, you know, 3 or 4 times a year, I would say, maybe a little more frequently. But the shipping. I can't get over the shipping. The shipping is almost the cost of a skein. And I was planning a trip to Paris in the winter that ended up falling through. So I had thought, well, I'm going to go to Paris and I'm going to go to her shop and I'm going to freaking load up on her yarn because it's so beautiful. But I ended up canceling that trip, for reasons that are not very interesting. And I saw that she was coming to Vogue Knitting Live. And so I went onto her website, and I decided what color I was going to get before I got there, because I had a feeling I read that she brought 1,500 skeins of yarn, which is crazy. I hope she took nothing home, because she shouldn't take anything home. Her work is so beautiful. And I picked a color because I knew I wanted enough to make a sweater. I wanted enough to make the majority of a sweater. Like if you check out my Ravelry shop, you're going to see that I work a lot in fingering weight yarn, and I like to do things like this where I combine two colors or three colors. I like to do a combination of yarns. So here I bought 3 skeins of this color here. I just think it's freaking beautiful. I don't know what I'm going to pair with it. I actually have another La Bien Aimée, the one that she did specific for Rhinebeck, that I may pair with it because I think it will work. But I don't know. I'm not opposed to mixing brands. So I might have a really cool Twisted Finch gold that I think would look great. But again, don't have a plan for this. Gonna figure it out. The color, in case you need to know, it's Le Littoral. I don't know what that means, except that I know Le is the. I think it has something to do with a book or reading. I'm not really sure. I just hadn't looked it up yet. But this is her singles base. When I went to her to the store on Friday, she said she was only selling singles. I don't know if she changed that for Saturday. I did go back to the booth on Saturday, but I didn't look at her stuff. I was just there hanging out and chatting with Petra from Undercover Otter, which I'm going to show you what I got from her next. My shawl keeps falling off, which isn't so good. Okay, so yeah, so I bought the La Bien Aimée. I felt lucky that I could get three skeins that went together and were the same color, and I paid for that as well as, wait, I want to show you. I hadn't quite picked out my skein yet, and I got this. This is a style award that they were giving out at Stephen and Penelope. It says for awesomeness in knitwear. And yeah, I just was so happy. And then I gifted my pattern to Jay Kim behind the counter, who gave me the award because he loved my sweater, my Big Bear Ski Bum sweater that I was wearing. And I gifted it to him. Anyone who came up to me, and this is just standard op for me, if you come up to me and tell me that you like what I'm wearing, I will offer you the pattern for free and then gift it to you right away through Ravelry. So I also bought this while I was there. This is Resting Knit Face Pin. So I bought this to pin my style award onto my sweater. So that was cool. And then, so I paid for that. And then I dove back in, and if you've ever been to Vogue Knitting Live, you'll know what I mean by dive back in. There was a huge crowd. So I dove back in to look at Undercover Otter's yarn and to meet Petra. Petra and I had talked via Instagram message a little bit, so I really wanted to just introduce myself and remind her who I was, because I'm sure she gets a ton of messages and things like that. And she was doing these really great little sets of what she calls otter pups. They're so cute. So it's five little samples of little minis of colors that go together. And so if you're like me and you can't decide what color, these are great because I was looking at the colors. I was trying to figure out what to get. I was like, oh my goodness, I don't have a plan. I just want to get something because she's here. It's not so expensive to have yarn shipped from Amsterdam, from the Netherlands, as it is from France. I find France shipping really, really high. But nevertheless, I really, really wanted to get some of her yarn. I just really love her color sense and the way that she puts colors together. Just so beautiful. So this is just a set of otter pups. It doesn't have a color name, but it was pink. And then I wanted a neutral. So she had a few neutrals that would go with it. So I picked this one. And this is called Pink Flamingo. So it has, it's basically a white base with black and pink speckles. It's really pretty. And this is on her singles base. She calls it Singularity. And these are Singularities as well. So I just thought that together might make a really interesting project. I don't know what it will be yet, but yeah, we'll see. We'll see. Okay. After that, I had been watching videos, many, 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 many videos. Woolenvine's video, Amy from Stranded Dye Works video, as well as Elsie herself from Skeined Your Knits. I had been watching some people knitting the Selbu mittens, so I knew I wanted some yarn, some really toothy yarn, very structured yarn that I could use to do color work mittens. So I looked at Christie's list and I tried to figure out where would be good to go, and I ended up here. I ended up at Flying Fibers Yarn Company, and I figured out that their base was DK, so that was exactly what I needed. And I saw the pattern. I looked at the pattern beforehand, and I knew I needed 50 grams of each color to do the color work mittens. Yeah, I fell in love with this color. It's like a variegated blue. This color is called Whippy Shale. And yeah, it's 100 gram skein, 262 yards DK weight, and I needed something to go with it, so I picked this gray, this beautiful gray. So I put their natural with it, and I put their gray with it, and I just thought the gray was more interesting. These are the same color, though. Isn't that weird? These are actually the same color name. They're just different dialogues. I didn't even realize that until I was like prepping for the video. But anyway, so it's 100 grams, so I could technically make two mittens. And then I saw this gorgeous, gorgeous yellow. It's called Rothwell. Wait, let me get it for you. Rothwell Gold. I just thought it was so pretty. It's actually looking a little more washed out on screen than it does in life. But these together, look at these. So I can do so many different combos. I'm super excited about like doing these two, or doing these two, or doing these two. And they're all 100 grams. So technically, I could make, so it's 300 grams. I could make three pairs, three different pairs. And when I got home, I wanted to show you this. When I got home, I had purchased this lovely, lovely book that's in Norwegian. And I learned about this from Amy of Stranded Dye Works. It's Selbu Vater by Ens Bardsgaard. What a great name. Holy crap. But look at the mittens. Oh my goodness. This is a beautiful, beautiful coffee table book. It was a little expensive, but I'm an academic and we buy books all the time. We're probably the only ones. But anyway, I just want to show you this on the last page. So I was thinking, like, if you look at the front page, let's see how everything's black and white. I was thinking, and I know that Scandinavian art or Scandinavian knitwear, when they do color work, they do it's white with a color, right? So I was having with my yarns, I was having gray, the gray stand in for white. Because their white was really yellowy and it's beautiful, but I wasn't feeling it as much. And in fact, I asked the salesperson, I said, "Do you like the gray or do you like the vanilla?" And with this blue and yellow I picked. And she agreed with me. She first said the vanilla, the more beigey, yellowy white. Unless their white's not white white. And then she came over to see that that was a good choice. So yeah, so they do white and a color normally. But then today, when I was looking through prepping for this podcast, I saw found this. Look at the colors, all the colors, and look. There's one, wait, right here. It's yellow and blue. I was like, oh my goodness, I didn't even see this beforehand, but my God, I love it. And this one, blue and white, and this one, gray and yellow. So great. So great. So yeah, I love this book. It's all in Norwegian, by the way. It's all in Norwegian, but it's full of beautiful, beautiful charts, and it's just such a gorgeous book. And if I really wanted to know what something said, there's Google Translate, right? Right, we're almost done. So my next stop on Friday, this was all Friday, was to go to Brooklyn General Store. It's somewhere that I've wanted to go, and though I live in the tri-state area, I live in New Jersey. I'm very close to New York City. It takes about an hour to get to New York, and then it would take another half hour to 45 minutes to get to Brooklyn. And I actually went to Brooklyn recently, but a different area of Brooklyn than where Brooklyn General Store is, and it was gonna really take me a long time to get over to Brooklyn General Store. Right now, I have two 23-year-olds. I have faux twins, which you'll hear the story eventually. I'm not gonna tell it now, but I have two 23-year-olds that are looking for an apartment together, and they're looking in Brooklyn. So I said to myself, if they end up living in Brooklyn and I go visit them, I hope they're in their region of Brooklyn General Store so I can go there all the time, because their store is just looks amazing and beautiful online. And I follow the store owner, whose name I don't remember right now. I follow her on Instagram, and it just seems like a really, really cool place to hang out. But so I went over there because I had heard from Christy Glass on her channel that she was carrying, she was going to be bringing Olan yarn from Ireland. That I guess it's something that she keeps in her Brooklyn General store all the time. So I have been obsessively following Olan on Instagram. I love her color sense and her yarn types, and she takes pictures of her little boy all the time, and he's so delightful and so cute, and it's really cool. I really, really love, she's such a good follow. I love to see her son and their morning walks, and it's like a nice way to start your day in the morning, because she's up way earlier than I am, since she's got about a 5-hour time difference. So anyway, I was really excited to see her yarn in person. I don't have any in my stash, but now I do. So I got two colors. I'm gonna show you both of them, and I'll tell you about each of them. Aren't they so beautiful? Look at them. I don't know what I'm gonna do with these either. These are singles. It seemed like everyone had singles in general, which I'm not I'm not like, oh my God, yes, singles type of person. I actually prefer it plied, because plied is more durable. But singles really work well for shawls, like what I have on. Anyway, I digress. I digress into one of my yarn lessons, which you'll get more of if you come back. Okay, this is superwash merino. This one is called Quarry. So freaking pretty. I just love it. I hope that it's really showing up well. It looks a little washed out on screen, but look at all those colors. This is like a multicolor, but it's muted and gray and gorgeous. And it is gonna fit in with other yarns that I have on hand. I'm so excited. And then this one's also amazing and gorgeous and rich. Look at these rich, 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 rich blues. This one's called Vessel. I love the idea. It's like, I love the way that the Irish culture informs some of the art choices. I've been my sister actually married an Irishman, straight off the boat Irishman, and so I've been immersed in Irish culture for a long, long while. I live with my sister and her husband in a massive, massive house, in a really nice family like orientation. So it's really, really cool. I love it. It's nice to have family nearby, and close by. So anyway, Irish culture, been involved in Irish culture for, oh my goodness, how old is my nephew? 20 years. Been living with them for 20 years too. Been living with my sister for longer than that. But yeah, I love that she chose the name Vessel for this. What a perfect, perfect name. One last stop on Friday. Where is it? I really wanted Shelly, I hope I'm saying the name of her shop right, Shelly Can. She was doing a special Vogue Knitting Live pen, which I thought I had to get. It's this little taxi cab. Wait, let me see if it focuses. Focus. It's a little taxi cab. The license plate says VKL 2018. I'm so happy I got it on Friday because they were sold out. When I was talking with Petra on Saturday at 1 p.m., she had told me they were completely sold out. She had bought one and she wanted to get one for her boyfriend, and she couldn't. So glad I went and got that. I knew anything that was specific to Vogue knitting, like the color that Beata made for Do You Knit, and this pen and Chrissy Glass's special yarn, I knew they'd be sold out. So super happy that I got that. So that was my Friday. I got there late, but I was still able to get through everything. I was there until I was there listening to them saying, Marketplace is closing in 10 minutes. But it was really awesome. It's much like if you ever go to Vogue Knitting, if you can manage to get there on Friday, the shopping is much more calm. The shopkeepers have more energy because it's the first day, and it's not as crowded. They're like at in the Stephen and Penelope booth, it was cuckoo crazy. A couple other booths were cuckoo crazy, just yarn flying everywhere. But you could get in. It wasn't like Indie Untangled at Rhinebeck this past fall, where you had to be a contortionist to get through booths and to get through that situation. But yeah, so I got that from Shelley, and I also got this beautiful pen. I love Lavender Loon, and I know that she has her own version of this pen, but I love the idea of the sun and moon. This one, mine is black. This one, Shelly sells the black one, and I think Lavender Loon sells one that's purple. I think it's purple. One day I'll get that one too, but I love astrology, and I love the ancient idea of astrology, I should say. And I love celestial objects and stuff like that. And I think it's really, really cool. One last thing. No, I got this on Saturday. Okay. So Saturday I really wasn't very productive shopping wise. I spent more time socializing. I spoke to Christy for a little while. I spoke with Petra from Undercover Otter for a little while. I walked around, and I headed back over to Brooklyn General because I had to have this gorgeous little acorn stitch holder, stitch marker holder. It's so, so cute, and it just works beautifully, and it's a great tool. It's genius. It's just genius design that I don't know who makes them for her, but amazing and gorgeous. And you can get them online. You can get them from Brooklyn General online if you really, really must have one. And then I made one more stop for yarn. And I had swung by I had spent a lot of time on Friday on the sixth floor. So I went to the fifth floor late. Brooklyn General was there. I made my purchases at Brooklyn General, and then I went to just kind of cruise around and see on the fifth floor, because I remembered from last year that on Saturday the fifth floor was a little calmer. It was not quite as packed, it wasn't quite as maddening, and it was a little more interesting to check out. My cats just kind of jumped up on the the thing I have to stand on, and if he'll let me, I'll show you him. He's adorable.
So cute. So cute. Mr. Cuteness.
So sorry about the rocking. He may make it rock again. So I went back to the fifth floor. That was my priority. I had sort of cruised around to see what things I might want to get, and I wanted to go home and think about it, because you can tell I bought a lot on Friday. I kind of did most of my purchasing, and I wanted to be very intentional and like get things that weren't easy to get, So I decided to go to one store on Saturday, besides going to Brooklyn General to get the acorn. I literally walked up to them and said, "Do you have any acorns?" They were like, "Yes, here you go." I paid for it and left. And then I made a beeline for this company. This is Fuse Fiber Studio. So I really fell in love with her. I'm kind of an MCN junkie, and I really fell in love with her MCN base. This is called Dad Sweater, and I bought the second color called Twilight. So they kind of go together in a really beautiful way. Hopefully, there you go. That's the colors right there. Don't know what I'm gonna do with them. I'll figure it out. But these are going in my library. Good additions for the library. They're really, really pretty and so freaking soft and so squishy. You could see how big they are, like compared to a single skein. Like, look at the difference. I mean, it's the same yardage pretty much, but so fat. So I found that really interesting. Really, really like her yarn. And I've been following her on Instagram for a while. I've had my eye on her yarn, just sort of trying to have a good excuse or have a good reason for why it is I should buy it. But yeah. Is that, no, I'm not quite done. Almost done. That's pretty much my Vogue Knitting Live, except that I did go to the Vogue Knitting booth. And I bought two things. I bought this. So I bought the 35th anniversary magazine. This was meaningful for me because I learned to knit in 1982 when Vogue knitting came back. So Vogue knitting had been around through the beginning of the 20th century, pretty much, and then it closed, and then it reopened in 1982. And I was a young teenager. I was, well, maybe I was an old teenager, I guess. I was 17. So I remembered Vogue knitting coming out. I loved the idea of knitting, but I hadn't learned. My mom knitted a lot and didn't teach me. She's a lefty, and she thought righties and lefties knitted differently. Because if you are a crocheter, and I crocheted, my mom had taught me to crochet. If you're a crocheter, then you know a lefty, and there's a difference between being a lefty and righty. And usually, in most things, there's a difference. But in knitting, there's no difference. My mother did not know that. So my mother, this is actually kind of a funny story. My mom had taught my older sister how to knit. My mom is an English style thrower, so which is, you know, she uses her right hand to throw yarn, just like we all do. And she told my sister, and she had told me the same thing. I was younger though, so I didn't. It was years later before I started to, before she, I told her I was interested in learning how to knit, and she was like, "Okay, here's what you need to do. You need to watch me from the reverse side so you can mirror what I'm doing. I'm a lefty. It's hard. I don't think I can show you, blah, 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 blah." So she had taught my sister. My sister's a continental knitter. I find it so funny because my sister watched her and mirrored her, mirrored what my mom was doing. So my sister is now and has always been a continental knitter, where me and my mom are English knitters. So I learned to knit actually in 1982. I got inspired most a little bit because Vogue knitting had such gorgeous patterns, and I was a fashion studies major. Like, I was planning to go into fashion studies, and I really wanted to learn about design work, and I had a goal of being a designer. And Vogue knitting had such fashion forward patterns and designs, and I remember like picking it up, picking the My parents at that point had moved from California to the East Coast and they now and continue to live in upstate New York, like a total little tiny touristy town in upstate New York. And so I lived with them for all my summer breaks from college. And I remember this in the summers being in their tiny little supermarket, and that market had Vogue Knitting Live. I mean, had Vogue Knitting, I don't know why. Vogue Knitting Magazine, I don't know why. But I would pick it up and I became interested. So I learned how to knit from Vogue Knitting. And so this 35th anniversary collector's issue, I was like, yes. I subscribed to Vogue Knitting early on. I was an early subscriber. And continued to subscribe to them until I became an academic, and then it didn't really, I don't know, I didn't have much time to knit. My kids were little, and I was spending a lot of time like making child-sized things, and I really wasn't making things for me. Probably a lot of you moms can relate. So anyway, I really, really wanted that 35th anniversary issue. And then the last thing I bought it on my way out, literally on Saturday night. Was the book. I just didn't want to carry it around, so I waited and I bought the Ultimate Knitting book, the Vogue Knitting book. I don't know if I have the original. You'd think I would, but I. It's funny, as a knitwear designer in the industry, I had a huge budget. I could buy a lot of resources. I bought a lot of books. I bought a lot of samples. I shopped a lot. I spent 2 days a week shopping as a designer. That's kind of the glamorous side of it. There's a very unglamorous side too, which I'll get into. It'll all come out eventually. But at that time, I probably had the Vogue Knitting book, the original one. It was probably part of my design library for my job. But I don't think I personally bought it. Because like I said, I was kind of a unicorn in a horse world. Because in the 80s, when I came out of design school, no one knew. People didn't really know about knits. They didn't know how to handle knits. They didn't know about knit fabric. They didn't know how to use it. And I had this unique knowledge as a hand knitter, that helped me bridge the gap. So I could bridge the gap between the cut and sew market and the hand knit market. And I was able to make that leap and make those connections for companies. So I was a valuable asset for companies at that time, at that point in time. And the knit market was just blowing up like crazy, because before that, those, like, if you think about a typical concert t-shirt, like in a guy's cut, that was all knitwear was. It was just those. And it changed completely from that to what we have now, where you can buy, the t-shirt I have on, it's just a plain J. Crew t-shirt that is cut for a woman's body. You couldn't find that until like the mid 80s. And people like Joan Vass were really on the cutting edge. And so I learned a lot from her and took that knowledge and then went off to do other things for other companies, and help them expand their knitwear products. Yeah. So I think that's it. I just want to quickly give you a little taste of, if you want to stick around to what I'll be talking about in the next episode, which I think will be in a week or two, probably 2 weeks. I think I'm going to do every 2 weeks. I think that's more manageable for my schedule. So I just want to tell you that I finished this Saturday morning, like right before I went over to Vogue Knitting Live. Like, I was literally like knitting it right up. In fact, when I was sewing the ruffles on, they were still a little damp, but they dried quickly and they looked really awesome. I have a picture on Instagram of them sticking out of my sleeve. I was wearing a leather jacket. It like just looked really, really cool. Really, really interesting look. The sweater's worth knitting just for these sleeves, I have to say. So I finished this, and because I had been obsessively knitting this, I knit this in 2 weeks, the whole sweater. It took me 2 weeks to knit it. I'm a fast knitter, but I'm also like kind of a multiple project knitter. So I don't always knit those things that quickly, but if I'm really concentrating, I can do it very fast. So, I got home and cast on three things yesterday. I don't know, I'm crazy. So I had stayed in New York City. My oldest son has an apartment right in Midtown, so it was like such a convenience, wonderful little place to stay. And his fiance is amazing and just a lovely, lovely person. And anyway, I came home on Saturday night, and the thing that I cast on, I just want to show you because I think it's interesting. I always learn stuff. I learn new things when I cast on and knit other people's patterns. So I feel like I am taking a voyage through their design process and through their brain and the way they think. So I cast on this sweater. This is the, let me see, a Boreal. By she goes by, I think her name is Jen. I don't know her last name. Maybe it's on here. Oh, Steingass. And she goes by Knit Love Wool on Instagram and on Ravelry. So I was curious about it. She's got some beautiful patterns, and she does things different than me. Definitely. I like color work, but I'm not obsessively designing in it. She seems to be really mastering the top-down yoke color work patterns, and she works in the Norwegian or Scandinavian tradition of knitting white with color. So I was interested in making one of her patterns, so I bought this before Christmas, and I told myself I would cast it on in the new year. And I stash dived to get yarn, and I, as you can see, almost everything I bought is fingering weight. That's the majority of my library. I have a little bit of DK and a little bit of worsted, but not much. I buy that more project oriented because fingering, it's, they're 20 to 25 to $30 a skein usually. Certainly they can be more money, but this pattern's written for DK, and I was like, DK weight, I need, it says, I think it's 14 skeins. 14 skeins. So 14 skeins. Wait, let me just make sure that's right because that sounds so huge. Gonna just make sure. Yeah, in my size, you need 14 skeins. So if you buy indie dyed yarn, DK weight, it's still the same $25 that the fingering weight is, but it's half the yardage. So 14 skeins times 25 was gonna be a lot more money than I wanted to spend. So just to make this pattern. So I went stash diving to see if there was stuff in my stash I could make. And I had just come back from Rhinebeck and I had bought this. This is this gorgeous natural Cormo yarn. I picked up one skein because I wasn't sure what I wanted to do, and I figured natural I'd be able to buy it elsewhere. And it's from a, let me see if I have the thing. It's from a person who, yeah, here it is. No, that's not it. No, this is it. Okay. It's from Fox Hill Farm, and I figured I could get more if I wanted it, like when I figured out what to make. And then I got this idea to make this sweater. So this is my white in the leaf pattern. See the leaf pattern? So that's the white. And then for the body, I got creative. I got really creative. I don't know if you know this, but this is kind of a good thing to keep in mind, and it sort of gave me, putting this together gave me license to buy more fingering weight. So DK stands for double knitting, and it's double knitting because it's two strands of fingering weight held together. That's double knitting. That's what double knitting stands for. Two strands of fingering weight. For some reason, fingering weight was a standard, sock weight, whatever you want to call it. And DK became the second standard. So this is the equivalent of DK. And I have a lot of fingering, so I thought, well, I'm putting some together. So I created a montage of shades of purple. So this is I did kind of a fade. So see, this is the one part of it. I'll tell you who the yarns are from in a minute. They're almost all Garn Story. So that's next. You just have to kind of follow along with me here because I can't fit it all on screen. And then was this. Then goes this. So see how that's kind of a fade? And then after that comes this. So I pulled together how many skeins? 1, 2, 3. So I have two of these. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 7, right? So if you think about it, DK, these are around 400. These are probably a little bit more yardage. But DK's half as long. 7 skeins should do me, right? I hope so. We'll see. We'll see how. I'm very curious to see how it all goes. So I'm starting with these two together. And then I will phase in this one. I'll probably take this one out, this guy out, put this one in. So it'll be these two together. And then so on and so on and so on. So wait, I want to show you. I'll show you what it looks like because it's so pretty. I have a little start. Okay. So you can kind of see this is the neck. See how it's knitting? And I just started the leaf. Wait, let me come around here where I'm actually knitting. See the, I just started the leaf. See it? Look at how pretty though these two colors together look. Wait, let's see. There we go. Look at how pretty those marled colors are. They're just so pretty. Super excited about it. There you go. Those little hits of blue and pops of yellow and orange and gray. Wow. I love this. Loving the way this is coming out. And it's fun. Oh my goodness. Like the colors and watching the colors. So that for me is what's exciting about knitting besides like I'm a process knitter. Like I love the process of watching the color come together and make a really, really interesting fabric. What I don't love about this knit, I have to be honest, is that I'm knitting, so I usually knit my fingering weights on a 4 or 5, US 4 or 5. I'm not sure what that is in millimeters. I think it's 3.75, 3.5 or 3.75 millimeters. And this is knit on a 5, on a 3.375, and it's tight. It's really dense. Like this is going to be a really warm sweater, and I don't know if you're like me, but like I'm not hanging out outside where I need a really, really warm sweater a lot. I mean, I do a lot of walking to and from work, and my campus is big, and we walk a lot, but walking makes you warm. And so this is like kind of a dense knit. I'm not sure I'm gonna like the weight of it. Like I almost wish it was a bigger needle. But like I said, I always learn something. So I will learn all about this designer's brain process in doing this sweater. And then I'll be able to make modifications on future designs. Cause she's just came out with a design that's really, really beautiful. I started this because she's doing a knit along. So if you want to join her knit along, she's doing it completely on Instagram, and you just hashtag her design work, and it's cool. I mean, that was the kick in the butt I needed, right? Like, she did a knit along, she's doing a knit along, oh my goodness, I need to do it. Knit alongs are really fun, they're so much fun, they're just like a good motivator for me. Otherwise, I'd probably be lost in my own little design world. For a while. So that was one of my cast-ons. My second cast-on was I joined the Do You Knit Doodler, or sorry, not Do You Knit, scratch that, Christy Glass Knits Doodler Knit Along that she's just doing on Sundays. And I just started it. I'm a week behind because they started last week. And so I started mine yesterday, a little late, and I got caught up to where she's at with her daughter. So this is mine. This is my doodler start. I just finished the fifth wedge. The yarn is, the pink is Garn Story Bliss. That's this. So it's kind of a really mellow rose pink. I call it rose pink. Highly speckled. I love Garn Story. I'm sorry, I forgot to tell you, the majority of the yarn in my arboreal sweater is Garn Story. The first two skeins in that yoke are primrose yarns, which are easy to get for me. Garn Story, not so easy. It's from Germany. But like Hedgehog, I have collected a lot of Garn Story, and I have a lot of Garn Story in my library. I seem to have gotten a lot of pink, which is weird because I'm not a huge pink person. I like pink as much as I like everything else, but I'm not obsessed with pink. But anyway, so I have this pink. This is called Bliss. You can get it. She still has it. It's not special. Wasn't a one of a kind. The green that I'm using is special and one of a kind, or a few of a kind. It's by a dyer called Qing, which starts Q-I-N-G. Qing Fibers. She's in England. She doesn't dye a lot for her shop anymore. She used to quite frequently. Again, I built a pretty nice library of her yarn. This was part of an Easter story that she did, and it's, you really are not seeing the richness of this green. Maybe if I move it over here, you're not seeing the rich green that I see. I'm sorry about that. It's really pretty. And then my trim is going to be this. If you know the doodler pattern, there's a wide trim at the bottom. So this is a walk collection. It's called Provence, and she had put in parentheses that it's dark. Provence dark. I don't know if you can see that. And that green is called Satellite. And it's Qing Fibers. Merino singles. These are all, no, they're not all singles. I lie. The Garn Story is merino sock. Okay. So yeah, that was my second cast on. And my little witchy hat is from Undercover Otter. I bought it while she had a Halloween special going on. I love Halloween. And they're all living in my fringe supply bag, in Black Watch plaid. And I had to, when I got it, immediately sew on an eyeball patch because it's Black Watch, so it's an eye. It's watching you. I'll add other pins later. Let me just show you the other yarn. I'm sorry. I'm like, I'll get better at this. I just want to show you these yarns again. So these are Primrose. This is Like a Hurricane. And this is Astrology. Well, the blue and purple looks really good and really on point on here. For some reason, the yellows and greens are not looking so good. Every other yarn other than the Fox Hill Cormo that I showed you, that's the white, that I showed you before are Garn Story. Some of them are unique, like club colors. I think they all are club colors. Yes, they're all club colors. She must have been on a purple streak because she just did a whole lot of purple for a while. That's that. And my last cast on is one of my own designs. And this is based on my Big Bear sweater. I have, the Big Bear ski bum, which if I can figure it out, I'll insert a picture. But I am making it in worsted weight. So that's the other thing that I cast on. It's a bottom up knit. It looks really small, but it actually is just really, really bunched up. But it's this beautiful cormo. I don't know if I have the tag, but it's called Stone Yeah, I don't have the tag. It's called Stone Hill. It's a sheep farm in Wyoming, and they have their wool spun and milled in a mill in Maine. And it's just gorgeous. It's so squishy, and oh my goodness, so soft. I can't wait. I cannot wait for this to be done. But this worsted weight, so I'm making a worsted weight version because I recognize that not everyone wants to do fingering weight, and maybe you're not like into indie dyed yarn and you like more commercial, and you can make a worsted weight without spending $200, because if you want to do worsted weight and indie dyed, you're spending $200. Where if you're gonna do a fingering weight sweater, you're only spending $100. So it's, you know, it's an interesting little thing. But I cast this on. This was what I carried around at Vogue Knitting Live to knit on, because it was small and easy to carry around. I know people work with socks, and you're gonna walk around with socks. Socks are kind of their travel package. And you're gonna learn from me pretty fast. I'm not a sock knitter. Just not a sock knitter. I'm a garment knitter. I like to knit shawls too. Okay, and this is living in my Jezebel travel bag, which has the arm. This is the medium size bag. You can find her on Etsy. I'll put everything in the show notes, but you can easily put it on your arm and knit as you walk. As I do, because I have a long walk. Once I park on campus, I have about a mile walk, because our campus is massive and the walk is far. If it's warm enough, it's been very, very cold. I haven't been able to knit when I walk, but if it's warm enough to knit and walk, I knit and walk on my way up to the office, and it helps me relax and kind of think about what I have to do that day and the things that I need to get done. So, anyway, thank you so much for joining me for my Vogue Knitting Live and recap, as well as my haul and learning about me. And I look forward to seeing you again. I might talk a little bit more about Vogue Knitting Live because there's some things I left out, but I don't want to make this video any longer than it already is. So thank you. I'll talk to you later and see you.